Good evening. Hello. I'm Laurie Lynn Turner, Associate Director of the New School Graduate Writing Program. Tonight we are thrilled, as we always are and always will be, to co-host another incredible event with our friends at Cave Canem. This evening is a special evening of new works by Don Lundy Martin, Geffrey Davis, and Arisa White. So let's get started. I'd like to invite Nicole Seeley, the Program's Director of Cave Canem Foundation, to come up to the podium to introduce the three poets. Nicole?
Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much, Laurie Lynn, for that introduction. As you know, Cave Canem is a national organization dedicated to cultivating the artistic and professional growth of African-American poets. Since 1996, Cave Canem has been a home for Black poetry across the country. You can learn more about us, what we're up to, and ways to support by visiting our website, cavecanempoets.org. Please check out the back table where you can buy books and sign up for our mailing list. I'd like to thank our generous host, the New School, especially Laurie Lynn. Thanks also to our funders, Mrs. Giles Whiting Foundation, the New York State Council on the Arts, and the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs, and of course, all of you for coming out tonight. It is my pleasure to introduce Cave Canem Fellows, Geffrey Davis, Arisa White, and Don Lundy Martin. Geffrey Davis is the winner of the 2014 Anne Halley Poetry Prize, the 2013 Wabash Prize for Poetry, the 2013 Dogwood Prize in Poetry, and the 2012 Leonard Steinberg Memorial Academy of American Poets Prize. His work has appeared in Crazyhorse, Hayden's Ferry Review, Mississippi Review, Nimrod, and elsewhere. Revising the Storm, winner of the 2013 A. Poulin Jr. Poetry Prize, is his debut book of poems. Arisa White is the author of two full-length collections, Hurrah's Nest and A Penny Saved. Her debut collection, Hurrah's Nest, won the 2012 San Francisco Book Festival Award for Poetry. White has received residencies, fellowships, scholarships, or grants from Headlands Center for the Arts, Port Townsend Writers Conference, Rose O'Neill Literary House, Squaw Valley Community of Writers, Hedgebrook, Atlantic Center for the Arts, and so on. Don Lundy Martin is the author of three full-length collections, A Gathering of Matter, A Matter of Gathering, winner of the Cave Canem Prize, Discipline, which was selected by Fanny Howe for the Nightboat Books Poetry Prize, and her forthcoming collection, Life in a Box is a Pretty Life. She is a member of the experimental Black poetry and performance group, the Black Toque Collective, and assistant professor of English at the University of Pittsburgh. Geffrey Davis will begin, Arisa White will follow, and Don Lundy Martin will close. Please welcome our readers.
Thank you. Well, on this thing where I'm trying to, I feel like I said this last time, but I'm still working on not saying things between poems, so I'm just gonna just read. Right. King County Metro. In Seattle, in 1982, my mother beholds this man boarding the bus, the one she's already turning into my father. His style, if you can call it that, disarming disregard, a loud Hawaiian print shirt and knee-high tube socks that reach up the deep tone of his legs toward the dizzying orange of running shorts. Outside, the gray city blocks lurch past wet windows as he starts his shy sway down the aisle. Months will pass before he shatters his ankle during a Navy drill, the service discharging him back into the everyday teeth of the world. Two of four kids will arrive before he meets the friend who teaches him the art of roofing and soon after the crack pipe, the attention it takes to manage either without destroying the hands. The air brakes gasp as he approaches my mother's row, each failed rehab and jail sentence still decades off in the distance. So much waits in the fabulous folds of tomorrow. And my mother, who will take 20 years to burn out her love for him, hesitates a moment before making room beside her, the striking brown face poised above her head, smiling. My mother will blame all that happens, both good and bad, on this smile, which glows now, ready to consume half of everything it gives. This poem has an epigraph from the second book of Kings, and it reads, "And it came to pass, there appeared a chariot of fire and horses of fire, and parted them both asunder. And Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven, and Elisha saw it, and he cried, 'My father, my father.'" What I mean when I say Elijah man, that Sunday in Chehalis, my father testified, and I watched as he wept before the pulpit, his shoulders heaving, his hands clapping up thunder above our heads, his mouth open on the note of awe as he told us the promise God had made in the dream, to bring him home before he tasted death, to wake him with the scent of flowers, proof of his presence. I learned to cry like that, as if I could sprain the heart, the body hurting its way out. But that morning, my mind snuck back to the nights he took paychecks and split, sometimes for weeks, his head and body humming for dope, his wife and kids suspended by the boundlessness of waiting. If he returned, if his pockets were empty, if the locks had been changed, I'd watch from the window as he jumped and hollered, wide-eyed and ripping the gate from its hinges or shattering the windshields of cars along our street with his fists. How, as the sirens drew near, not even God could stop him. What my father might say if I let him speak. Son, I stayed spooning your mother's softly snoring form as she swelled with you month after month. Your voice pierced the Seattle spring air, and I began to wake in the early hours before work, my mind and body dragged from that otherworldly cavern of sleep to watch you flexing your life. I biked 3 miles home on lunch breaks to bottle feed you, begged your mother to make you wait. Stop turning these details toward a genesis for a lifetime of hanging on. I showed you what the living can do and call love, that a man can rise coughing from the ashes of himself and go back down again like prayer. This is my attempt at a funny poem. Sometimes you need that. All right. Meditation at a Pennsylvania diner, early morning. I order cranberry juice with my over-easy eggs and wheat toast, an impulse that lingers from my ex-wife's concern for my body and what it could not hold forever. What does it mean to name this moment Concord? With thousands of miles, 3 ranges of mountains, and a merciless silence between us. Let this drink order simply bless this morning, headed west, her way, still fat with possibility. My waiter's smile seems convincing enough. He's kept my coffee warm, and the toast arrives unburnt. Yes, just kids, we failed utterly to span that great domestic divide. We didn't have a chance. But I applaud those two for staying in it until the house burned to the ground. And now, if only for her ghostly part in ensuring I have enough cranberry juice to wash it all down, I wish her 100% of her daily vitamins when she wakes. a healthy portion of phytochemical nutrients and antioxidants, glasses of juice so fresh she could sing of a deliciousness to this world. I refuse the false concentrate this diner uses to become some dark hearkening to our misplaced faith and the deep red promise of wetland blossoms. We have every spring to recover, to gulp the aroma of blooms, lungs filled with the spectral sweetness of fruit we will never eat. I'm gonna break my promise. So I wrote this other manuscript that got boxed. So sometimes formal contracts help to give me, or conceptual frameworks help to give me permission to write about things that otherwise I'm not sure whether I should write about them, not even before how. And so I wrote this whole, and I stumbled upon this thing where it was, the stream of poems was like, write the memory of X, write the memory of Y. And then they sort of were driven by the declarative, like, remember this, don't forget this, tell how this. And something about like smuggling the risk or the stakes of getting it right helped me to sort of try to write about some of these things. And some of them were like moments that were small magic that I was worried about doing something, diminishing the experience of magic. And so only two of them survive in this book, so I try to keep them alive. And it's this one titled, Write the Memory of the Girl Dancing in Apple Blossoms. Tell how in the orchard's middle, the petals just rained down as she danced around the trunk of the tree. Describe her arms raised into the Y of worship or request. Although you knew better, it looked as if she held up the sky, as if she'd conjured the tree and its sudden shedding of pink-white blossoms. Then you noticed the father in the branches above, smiling. Remember how uncertain you became, if he knew the miracle he was making, if he could feel her arms suspend him there. This poem is What We Set in Motion. It's in four parts. One. Months out from my bout, I return home after training deltoids and biceps to push past the letdown of exertion, to never stop throwing punches. Our baby boy bides time in Elle's belly, 2 weeks late, and she smiles, names me her gentle boxer as I shadow my way down the hall toward the shower. The next day, after 0 centimeters worth of progress, she sends me back to the gym to spar, to save my mind from running the unnecessary laps. I spend round after round risking and taking damage in search of that perfect left hook to the body, that soft midsection crunch. I land a few home and feel the accuracy moving deeper than mechanics, burying itself in the blue memory below. Inside the ring, I sweat out everything but bob and weave, but balance and breath, bearing each combination's bad intent until brutality blossoms into something almost beautiful. Two. And then it's time. As in the dark, we're in it. Maternity wing of the hospital, the lengthening hours of our son's slow arrival. As in the dark, a contraction's wave ends, the wash of pain receding, and Elle leans back into the rocking chair, back into the chasm of exhaustion, eyelids locking her exit from the room. I squat before her and wait, her body buoyed in the open sea of labor as in the dark. My gaze fixes on the map of monitors, scanning that pixelated horizon for the next contraction's approach. When it does, as in the dark, her eyes flare inside the room once more, hands raising to clasp behind my neck as in the dark. I hear the moan of her spirit bearing this being into light, and I lift her loaded weight, place pressure on her hips and say, give me everything, darling, as in the dark. There is no word for the infinite divide between my desire and my inability to rock this boy's burden from her, to rock her from the tides of hurt he's riding in on. This is all her. As from the dark, as from the sea, another wave builds inside her, and I send whispers across water, coaching her deeper into the swallow of its force, calling it what we want, calling it love or joy or peace as in the dark, barely trusting each moment that moves her further from this shore, where I wait for her to plant our son into these arms. 3. When they tell us no more fluids, when they tell us time has scorched the well of his arrival, when urgency cuts through each gowned voice in the delivery room, the ghost in Elle's face says, let them. And so we let them mine him by fire, with and through fire. Restraints, no breath. Regional anesthesia, no breath. Nerve block, incision, hemorrhage, and then he adds the sharp thunder of his cry to the elements. They place him at the altar of her chest, with one hand free to touch the curl and moisture of his hair. Smoke clears from her smile. 4. In the nursery, this new kind of quiet stretches itself inside the plastic hospital-issued bassinet. And I stare at my feet, a sudden fear over the distance down to them, over having no prayer for looking into our son's face years from now, finding it thinner, the flesh pulled tighter around the cathedral of his skull, the mind behind his eyes more like ours, more tacked to the brittleness of yesterday, days stacking into months, memories like seeds spilled across another year. What's the ritual for forgiving ourselves, the mortal promise we set in motion, pressed between the floral sheets, planning his life's fabric into death's seam? And I'll close with this one. And this is what I mean when I say farmhouse. Time's going has ebbed the moorings to the memories that make this city kid part farm boy, until a smell, close enough to the sweet musk of horse, tunes my ears back to tree frogs blossoming after a country rain. I'm back among snakes, like slugs wedged in ankle-high grass, back inside that small eternity spent searching for soft ground, straining not to spill the waterlogged heft of a drowned barn cat carried in the shallow scoop of a shovel. And my brother, large on the stairs, crying. Each shift in the winds of remembering renders me immediate again, like ancient valleys reignited by more lightning. If only I could settle on the porch of waiting and listening, near the big maple bent by children and heat, just before the sweeping threat of summer thunderstorms. We have our places for loneliness, that loaded asking of the body. My mother stands beside the kitchen window, her hands no longer in constant motion. And my father walks along the tired fence, watching horses and clouds roll down against the dying light. I know he wants to become one or the other. I want to jar the tenderness of seasons, to crawl deep into the moment. I've come to write less fear into the boy running through the half dark. I've come for the boy. Thank you.
Thank you, Geffrey. So I must read first from Harasnas, which is a memoir, kind of, in verse, pretty much about growing up in Brooklyn, and my mom was a Rastafarian, and all that fun stuff. So I'm going to start with the opening poem, which is a Sistina, and I'm one of seven children. So the Sistina repeats six words. So I chose my siblings' names, Jamar, Kayana, Shaquana, Nigel, Uriah. I got them all. Yeah, I think that's it. And Ibert. And Ibert. Okay. To you, name the messenger of God. I came into an extended family of boys whose skin knees in rough played. Jamar firstborn in the weather of her womb. Ibert mourned the light that drained him from her cupula. Kayana came normal, then the tonic-clonic brewed her brain. Shaquana broke waters with six pointed hands. Nigel arrived on the golden bell's 12th toll, and you, Uriah, rode a love inexhaustible, inducible as Jah or art. Wear her seven wonders and sins. In nights of hell, she gave us ice lullabies to cool our sleep. Still I burn in the crook of her cradling, troubled by the face we share. Her voice, sha-sha notes of incomplete comfort. I body myself like a kayak into what shore I pedal. I am Kayana, seized in epilepsy, shaken to stillness, wake to find home is her. A blue wryness colors this epiphany of hands aching for the soil of her laughter. No shaman with leaves or cowries reading godly scripts could jam such truth into my eyes. Far away we move in the strictness of her lines. Ibert in Nicaragua is pulled by her moon. In the mandolin's quiet, Nigel finds her climbing his clefts. Every good boy does fine, niggles his ears. Strung by deaf fingers, her effects linger longer than Cayenne. She's obey a woman's curse cast when he, a toddler, swells Ibert's neck until speech is the faded note pulled from the bottle. You liar, I write in Mother's Day cards for her missteps and neglect. Jamar picks no bones. I direct the skeletons with my pens. Shaquana with bold fonts points and shames. Far too many times we were Nigel, unsafe in boyfriend's hands, wilting while his skin rose in welts. No Jamar, no police, just the fusillade of K.K., the missing O's we kept for salvage selves we floated away. Uriah, you do not know the wrecks, our possible flights. Ibert from monkey bars landed with broken sky in his hands. I bent into a fetal memory, sucked the genie from my thumb. Shaquana sprinted, her arms swinging machetes. For seconds she lifted. You are an addition to this breath, listening to each shell and the way Nigel studies sounds, predicting how to fill the holes, tricking Kayana into falls. And for what spot soft enough we lift the other sadness. We jambu against collisions come low. Uriah, you are protected in Ibert's prayers. In Jamar's and Shaquana's eyes, your beauty's given back. You brown in Nigel's sun-soaked scales, and we choral psalms from Kayana's watered vowels. It was easier to manage. I started kindergarten that fall you went off to Guyana. Granny cut off my dreadlocks. She knew how to press and curl, ponytail and cornrow, but palm rolled locks till the roots stiffened with beeswax, glistens like licorice, she didn't know. For that matter, no one in the projects knew what to do with hair left natural, left unparted and wild. They were afraid to touch that unmothered part of themselves. Each snip made each one alive and each one dead. And if you said goodbye, it was an honest whisper, short and fine, in your throat. She cut my hair like a boy's who hadn't gone to the barber for a month, and I sat at the cafeteria table alone for weeks. They couldn't make sense of me and my classmates with their gender-proper hairstyles. I didn't want anything to do with franks and beans, those pucks of grilled meat. I waited at lunchtime for peanut butter and jelly and was hesitant to eat bread that wasn't our color. It was hard not hearing your voice each morning throughout the day, and unwilling to correct them when they said my name wrong, I gave into the sizzling. The fried chicken crunched between my teeth. I could have bitten both of your hands for leaving me here, each finger for the gunshots that rang the night, the footsteps running on the roof, the gravel mashed deeper and deeper into my sleep. Flocks of butterflies broke my skin and I was shattered where I stood. A whole constellation of wondering if I could throw myself to the sky, coat it with urgent wishes, you would see that I missed you, that the barter was unfair, that you mistook me for sheep. I guess this is my attempt at a funny poem. Last bath for my brother Jamar. The bubbles die and there's a different life ahead of us. The once continent turns to islands, fish school close to our bellies. Seeing underwater is a collision on my eyes. The water takes out my braids, turns cold because I didn't want them like seaweed. You turn the shower on and there's no point worrying. We drown in a storm of beads, impatient beads that don't hold still for threading, and sharks come at the wrong time. I'm past pruning but still must save my tail. It's our monkey bar talent that saves us or whatever keeps the curtain rod in the wall. How are you? I'm good, but my armpits are caving in though. Laughter splits us. We agree eating chocolate ice cream is cannibalistic. My teacher has shoes older than me, and Mr. Bergman lets anger devil his face. I pray to God he won't be my fourth grade teacher. What would Granny say, us using her panties for parachutes? Let's land somewhere where we are lost and found, new water in Argyle mitten. A map from day to day. From many shells we crawl, no porcelain tubs fill with crashes. We whistle from every jar, scrap a moment with shine and ditties. I smell you. We are that close, how Granny would say, like those good times when I was your age. Ribbons in straw. On mornings like this, I find her shirts and pants puddled at her feet, my mother sewing. The knit and stitch of parted skin puckers, stuff back into herself the ribbons and straw that fattens her. She hums a note, starved for more sound, I hear like a baby. I touch my insides over and over until I'm something I can put in my mouth. It's frightening to think my mother belongs to me. I see her walk down the street, crushed between King James's lips, and when she's close enough to grab my hand, she's a box of buttons. I'm lonely for life in her hands. My mother, who cannot rescue her heart from the barrel of her chest, always stealth in her love, always without the proper ear, without the proper conduit, without the sand purling between her toes, without her calendar of holidays, without her Magdalene at her feet. She looks best when mortar, when I trust her to hold things together. In navy, she sails, returns, and the notch on the doorframe has gone from here to there. We meet each other with owls in our mouths. The first to show me upon a pomegranate how to eat one, red breast in her palm, she sliced into quarters, peels off the white skin gently like a woman's shirt, her collar blushes at fourth touch. The sun brings down its shade, she lies asleep. I pull back her skin and lick the butter. She is a season of too much salt. Guarded in her swim, she's a strange monarch washed in waves. Her bramble hair and brand new coils have tailored the fence around her face. Always, always, I'm fumbling to unlock the grief. I've given too many cards for the refrigerator door. She's a magnet for one. I tell people I leave only intentional trails. I leave my mother in the crowd. She calls like Grand Canyons want to fill. Pulls and persuades my body that no injury will come of this welcome. Nowhere will nest me. Glass holds the signature of letting go. She stands between a blow. Her body smarts, learns it cannot take the same intensity. Her emotional wells, her towel cape, she cries over her toes. I hold her like an artery above a river. Okay, and the last one from Haraznas. The small places I go. I hide from the light and beneath the covers of lids, and where I go is tinted with the color in which we mark our errors. This sadness makes me stamp size. To linger in the corner with all the hush and whisper, I will never find this part without absolute quiet, and then what will I do with it? I prefer the hem of things, the circumference of cotton wrists, woolen torsos, limp parasols of skirts, the husk of ourselves hang in quiet, gestures no want or need. I don't like them very much on some days mostly. Among these bodies built tall and lumbering, I want to axe their legs, yell timber, to cut my mother's tail she chases in the sport of catching herself. I can offer a quiet fall to each of them. I landed first between yellow lines cushioned by the push and pull of traffic. When I say my brother's name, I call him into the crash and fracture of organ and bone. It is his decision to let me cross the street alone. He runs for mother, and to this day his sorry remains lost. When the enclosure is embracing, I imagine no one's arms. There is no heart to squeeze. It's better when there's no brother who suffocates me with a pillow. I pull breath out of down the way fish get air from water, like it is better when the lightning is not my mother's. She has a skirt that looks like a street. Stripes of white run the middle. She is the vehicle that drives this article. Across the hips, I'm dare-eyed, holding the road like the only home we have. I cannot sue her accidents. What does it matter when I say we do not like him? She is a woman of muffled ears. It's winter when it comes to my words. This is how I mend the pain. I take a spoon heated on a gas range to my sister's thigh. Not a scream or yell, a glimmer of a jolt. She is us. Look how we withdraw from our skin like underwear, socks, our best school clothes, and when they are too hard to wear, we pass them along and no one notices the keloids, the restitching in awe of starch increases. When they find me asleep on the closet floor, my brother and sister say, "We heard you talking." My mother smiles. Why do they come find me? I need the meters and yards to imagine a blackness that blends me with roads and nights, slips me from the corridors that remind me of how their faces dull the treasured parts I want to keep and shine. What you come to meet at ends, ports and shanty towns, me folded like a note waiting to toss myself to any wave, muscle enough to get me back. Really, what is the point of the sun's ritual? The light and heat of its circling, if what rivers through me is a hunger, the drought and flood of it. So A Penny Saved is based on the story of Polly Mitchell, who was held captive in her home for 10 years in Nebraska. And during that time, she had four children. So I reimagine her story. She's held captive for 12 years. She has three children instead. I write from the point of view of Polly, her husband, her oldest daughter, and her oldest daughter's imaginary friend, Julie, and also from the point of view of the house. What I'm going to do is primarily read from Polly's voice. And so let's start. No, actually, I'm going to start with the voice of the house. House, seven rules to still life. Rule one, under any circumstances, you're not allowed to leave the house. He volts her hair until she grows roots. Her skin dries back a you. If her hairs tangle, he suspects it's liced with trips to the mall with stops at the Dairy Queen. It must in another man's back seat. Rule two, do not open up the windows or doors for any reason. What tracks her hair are reports of the carpet's fuzz, tiny dives in recessed linoleum, how the bathroom's chiclet tiling gets stuck in her cowlick. There's no wind to speak of. Rule three, you are not allowed to answer the phone. Her eyes always in the cool cobalt of the television's autumn. If outside comes in, the pigeons would enjoy her branches, peck her wooden fissures. This is she often her willow ways in Afghan fashion. Rule four, you do as I say, no back talk. Once she was a mug, the one with her name on it, one hand on hip, she spent the entire day sipping 20 ounces. The caffeine wound her quickly to snores. The room sludged in Senka. Rule five, you do not go anywhere without me. Sometimes wailing arms, she orchestrates the brush of 1,000 webs in a fit of swirls that spirals her down to sobbing. She unspools like a heap of telephone wire. Rule six, we don't keep company. What goes on in this house is nobody's business. Rarely an armadillo. She turns off lights, leaves the curtains drawn, windows Christmas wrapped. Her bony plates clink against the furniture's legs. She sniffs steps of a heavy weight's waltz, digs up buttons, ceramic crumbs, peas from a night's dinner. Rule seven, you will be severely punished for breaking these rules. Today, a bowl of lemons and canary shout across cushions. She puckers like the nipple ends. The air drinks her scent. Tart are these summer days. And this is the voice of Polly. I hum a song that moves the porch swing in my throat. Before I opened up the prayer and let the birds out and abandoned all hellos in the phone's helix, I was young. The stars requested certain notes from me. She answered back, mocking the lyrics I made, Andrea. Two houses down from the planet that always twinkled back, the years left no tracks between us. I wish again a friend would arrive with a grip to stir me from his spooning, call to my sill with a constellated jar. Instead, I'm given to an ovation of wind and water to occupy the mouthpiece when anyone calls and bleep bleep to fleece the facts. I can't forgive my torso with his sweet tooth for shouts that never break the barrier of skin or burst over roofs a carnival of balloons that resist the knot around my wrist. These urges pass. The dirty laundry never airs. Acherian messages melt before they reach. And so I will close out with David tells me. David's her husband. David tells me, my pops got an addictive personality, started smoking when he was 11, then quit at 50. Then it was the magazines, the exotic instruments, cigars, baseball cards, souvenir spoons, and now it's guns. He has all kinds of them, rifles, pistols, shotguns, and started collecting antique ones. Said, You have to protect your heart like Jesus Christ came real life in front of you and said to do so. Any measure is a loving measure, so if you want her yours, you keep her yours. No man other than you boys should be putting his eyes on her. That's how they claim her, hook her like a whore. It's more than devil, it's those bullshit romance novels and soap operas. They get bored, want something different. You got to break that until the bit's too small to break. Then pound it down, make it a medicine fine, feed it to her. If I could do it all over again, I wouldn't have let your mother leave the home. That's how she got it in her head to divorce. Now I keep my hand heavy in hell, and it should be no other way. You're the man, son, make her wear skirts. That way she'll be ready for you every time. She wants to be an animal, the pet you keep in the tank, and if you can find someone to go on the ride with you knowing not well, honestly, she's waiting on your go. Take care of her needs. Let her worry about not leaving you. He stopped polishing his Custer range, pointed it straight at my head, said, you can smell that Indian blood, can't you? You're looking at me like a bump on a log. I ain't raised no bump. Go get yourself a gun, boy. Nothing too fancy as this. Keep it next to you, close by to grab at any second you need to set it right. And with that, David locked the 9mm in his nightstand, the two keys like two women, holes in their head, hung around his neck. Thank you.
Hi, it's so good to be here. It's weird actually being in this building because, I never come in this building, but like 11 years ago, my poetry career was, if there is such a thing as a poetry career, was launched because I won this Poetry Society of America Chapbook Fellowship, like the first one or whatever that they did, and we had this big reading downstairs in the big auditorium, and the strange thing for me, other than winning that, was that it was about a week after my father died. So I had this kind of, dual personality or dual being thing happening, I think, in that room, to kind of feeling this celebratory mood at the same time, mourning this complicated figure in my life, who was my father. So I say that as a kind of means of introduction to Discipline, which I'll begin reading from. So Discipline is a book of prose poems. They're linked prose poems, so it's kind of, I don't know if it's one poem or if they're linked poems, like whatever. They're all untitled. And part of them, part of the poems are attending to this existence in the wake of my father dying, and some kind of reflect back on the process of his dying. And then the other part of it, there's this question at the center of the book, which is, about agency. So there's interweaving narratives, and the questions that were on my mind were, the difference between making a choice, being compelled, being disciplined, if you can kind of negotiate that as a human in the world, whatever. So I'm just going to read, so think of them then, I think, as part of a long poem. I'll read you part of this long poem, and then I'll move to Life in a Box is a Pretty Life, which is a kind of continuation, I think, of the investigation started in Discipline. Here we go. Or fat, choked skin lounges against wire fence, orifice undone, a location like any other location, incidents in the midst of unkempt propulsion. What is your ancestral stock? I am here too, contracted muscles. I simplify things by pretending to resist. Or what are your measurements then? Try to count backward from this. Try fixation on isolating the parts of the body. Try glue guns and known systems. Periodically, a different seismology. Great gaping things. The eye wants what it wants. Hem drag or what airs on the side of attachment. Preening and primordial, this is our zoo. The organs in a fit of attempted resistance, saying to each other, let me. If permission is granted, it is only temporary. An official language describes it all. Multiple growths, diseased marrow, these percentages, survival, and what denotes healthy. So, comb the hair. When he returned from the hospital for the first time, hair matted and down his neck, I cut my father's ridged hair in the kitchen with electric clippers. While the blood perverts, we get control of a single fluttering mass. At the window, she bellows because it is something to do. Glittering phenomenon outside the window, symmetry between what is outside and what is inside. That likeness or coagulation stretches into what one could call saturation. A woman in the window is seen from the glittering ground outside the window, her mouth clearly open, sounds clearly emanating. We say broken witness. The woman enters the store once enters the space once empty, occupies brown space with other brownness, both in abstraction. So we say, if the space and the woman are brown, what happens to the empty? I, too, am often misrecognized in the dark, even here where I had believed I was known or at least would not be mistaken. It's a strange sensation to yell out, this is me, at the very moment of being misseen and human, but utterly so. This is how much fortuitousness weighs, measure in dirt, of vices and other habits, of leaving a house at 3 a.m. and drawn as would any tether, and here is your lock, my dear. I want to say this plainly. It is only when I'm in a woman's arms that my body is not a threat. Neither crosses nor damnation, fix nor flutter, hangs here, this balance, and one opens the car door and drives along the river where it is said a crossing might happen, had happened many times. Sticklers will say, not here, there are no crossings here. But there is the eye, reflection and delivered on the other side, like hams holding on to what was. Before the whelp of a certain bird, the crack of morning, the body's milking loss. If there is a prayer, there is a mother kneeling, hands folded to a private sign. We recognize it. If there is a mother kneeling, hands intent, she is praying or she is crying or crying and praying at the same time. Although it is recognized, the signals of it, it is private and no one knows, perhaps not even she, the content of the prayer and perhaps its object. If there is a mother praying, she is on her knees over some object as she does not often pray in the middle of the room. One prays at the window or over the bed, the head bent slightly up or down, the eyes open or closed. This is a prayer for prayers, you know, a wanting something equal to the prayer, even though I am not a mother. They watch a girl slip into a car and close their shades. Before, slides, figures insistent on nothing. Impotent men live in the house. The older one beats the younger one until he surrenders as would paper. Finally, all is quiet. no more weeping or begging. I wanted all my life for my father to die, and when he did, I felt empty. Voice in our head, persistent. Voice in our head, barely audible. Noise comes down as a dark shade locks out the light. The curb, wet and black, an obstructive haze, perseverance of unknown, bodies in slow motion engaged in pursuit through action, through terse pleasure, concentration of single acts, a hand there, the mouth doing whatever, the body's wound position, the first invitation to the trance-like state. I'm going to stop there with discipline. So what happens in Life in a Box is a Pretty Life is, oh, you know, I'm going to actually read, I'm changing my mind. I'm thinking, but I'm talking at the same time, right? So I'm changing my mind. This is a meta reading. So I'm going to read from Life in a Box is a Pretty Life, but you know, I'll say that like the world gets even darker, if you can imagine, in terms of like, you know, optimism and Life in a Box is a Pretty Life. So there's this way in which, you know, there are these questions at work in discipline. There are questions of, you know, agency, what can we do, how can we move through the world? But here, it's like there is no hope, you know? Like we're all imprisoned. We're imprisoned in these boxes of like, you know, society. We're imprisoned in these boxes of the body, the female body, the black body, the queer body, whatever, right? So these utterances happen in that space. And I want to say that I have some friends here who I'm in a collective with. And so I'm going to read a little bit of that libretto as well that happens at the end of this utterance. So you'll hear some of that if you know this libretto. Okay. So the first piece is titled Modern Frame or a Philosophical Treatise on What Remains Between History and the Living, Breathing Black Human Female. It's after Carrie Mae Weems's Framed by Modernism from 1996. To feel a presence, they say, can be like a haunting. You are yourself and no other being is there, yet a feeling or sensation emerges as if from nowhere. Like the negress, the black female body not in repose, instead walking or clickety-clack. It knocks at the door, which is the surface of existence, or in life it walks down the street and is asked to assume a position of slackness in response to the perception of being in perceptual heat. What would we do without her? How would we know ourselves? Indeed, we need something against which the pristine can manifest itself, can create its artifice of pristineness. To be adorned or unclothed, light bursts. Glare from fluorescent mouths breathe their profit into me. No one hears the glass sound of breath. Just me. Was, quote, low, they say, quote, fastened in place by violence, was, quote, ritualized, was, quote, debased, was, quote, grotesque, was, quote, black flesh, or, quote, swathed in, quote, blackness, and, quote, finality, and, quote, nature, was, quote, centralized. In standing repose, the object lures us into a belief that she is indeed human. We know this from her sun-draped eyes, her capacity for deceit. We see no absolute proof, however, that the artist outstretched offering the Mammy Trophy and the, quote, fantastic Al Jolson performing his signature tune. Enter machines and abstractions, automations to lengthen legs, round edges, plump buttocks, relational fish, irrational fissure. All this shimmery ache in one place suddenly against your back. My body aflame with it, can't you see? Make an outline around my form. Use your chisel. I will indulge your every little fit. I, your perfect muse, your blank, blank, your everything, also your nothing. Insofar as the phrase, quote, black woman, replace outside of domestic, quote, power. I lie down in the ditch myself, stretch my body alongside the dead myself. Outside the frame, oblique lover, de Kooning maybe as a young beauty, his hand reaches in to retrieve me and pets me, my nakedness a fine scratch, filament traces in the historical body. Representation falls away. Chokehold, quote, blackness. Swallowed, quote, brown. Your, quote, black father, whose, quote, blackness precedes him, stumble in laborious, quote, black gait toward, quote, absence. Cross your, quote, black hands. Empty your, quote, black pockets. Hold your, quote, poor, quote, black baby against a, quote, brick, quote, wall as instructed. And the, quote, niggers get, quote, sold up the, quote, river against a, quote, lithe, quote, white, quote, fluff. You wail, a mimic mouth into beaded rhythms of usness, fragrance of a cosmos where roads are not partitioned. No roads, no marks to mark up the whole big wide world. The holes of universes untethered from time, in absence of wholeness, catch glimpses of the sides of selves. If we could be without him, we would. Is there any country without him? We are told of the reservoirs, that they are without sea or wind, that we attach, laconic, swerve, and hold what has happened to it. Trauma sack. What strikes me, she says, is how easy it is to commit atrocities. Remove from experience rain, unnurture the physical form. A girl is just a girl, one ass cheek on a full chair, balancing. Remove skin, water, sunlight, love. Position the neck so that landscape dissolves into brick wall. Excise language puffs from pharynx. Unfurl the scroll. Hear ye, hear ye. I'm going to skip to the portion that I referenced earlier. So I'm in a collective called How Do You Say Yam in African. We had a piece that was scheduled to be in the biennial, the Whitney Biennial, but we pulled it. And I'm going to read one of the speakers' voice from this libretto. And the title now of this section is Without Knowing the Slightest Thing About War, I Find Myself an Instrument of Labor, Investigation, and Experiment. What are the dimensions of the field? They've put me here in the tallest grasses and strangest fruit and have demanded at gunpoint that I bend into it over and over. But I am so tired and my limbs are sore. And I feel disconnected, or I disintegrate. A shadowy figure towers over me as I exhaust, body buckle, ballast removed. When the dirt is black enough, when my hand is strong enough, I dig into it, open space, and fall through other side to a black sound, a black stone, familiar thieves, Urdu, or the last language we spoke before mother's milk. They circle around me, clasping wrists, and I yell into a hole in the earth, in earth. My palm proffers oromo, undoing silt, breakaway. This is the body bending over my body. They have encircled me with their manacled tongues, but I do not understand them. My form is small and lean, but they think I am large and bull-eyed. What is yielded here is nothing. No sign of blood, no sign of dripping, no ache, only my small form without space around it. What is the body but a leaking form? No room for leaking. A form so tight around my form it cannot seep or gesture. Complete enclosure. To hold a drop of water is extreme labor. The tongue against ground, the difference between experience and dreams fall away. There are locks in every corner like little eyes. Even time no longer passes, each fractured second redundant, artifice of time, of location, my father's red eyes. If there is a wandering, I do not know it. The eye lock has its determinate grip. When I open my mouth, someone else speaks words that happen in my dreams as islands. Jaw agape, a work of wheezing. Each day to the river, but dry. Weight of crackling. In the hand, a mass of grandfather's thin hair, wind mass. A voice speaks soft into ear, says irretrievable, says the dog too cries mama. Hair, a spare mass of grief. How to make the self distinct amongst white whales. A dead fawn under machinery. I am the machinery. I'm also the end of the sentence. In heat they want me. Also to lap at their crotches saying thank you because their syntax wants definition of this body. All the colors. It is you who are they. From inner valve, an orphic effort, a monument force against your greed feast, your half-lidded gulps. You ruminate. You vomit into the mouths of fawns. You say, I love you. I love you. Wound resurface, unlocks a face in my hand, white sinews visible. It startles this flesh against skin, a reminder, but for tree depths, I can see them. My reflection, stone black as ice, bulging body, a root to depth, obscured by hammer of whiteness. Organs collapse in bright fortress. My form removed from its home, its warmth, its sustenance. They tell me I have enough, that I am not dying, but I see my own gray legs ashen. To witness the floor, and then it's me on the floor. Carry of the draped body, feet first, already a hole forked. My spirit confused from return. The slaves blink their slow eyes. They pull their tie knots close to collars. Dead wings, faces bald and speak with ease. Boom, the voices go. My head, an empty vase. They will tell you that I was sick, that I was a drug addict. They will tell you I died a natural death. Sometimes young people just die, they will say. We don't know why. They will say I was lazy, that I could not work because of disease and just general feebleness. When a crime is committed by a white man, they will show you a photo of me instead and call me a trickster. In the photo, my jaw is slack, my hair wild. They will say that I am unkillable, that my body resists battery by tree trunks, bullets, and years in small cells. When I enter a store to buy something, I will be immediately arrested, and then they will apologize. I'm just a child, I will say. Impossible to be so greasy and a child, they will say. There are no children anymore. Why are you so sad, they will ask me. Why is your heart so weak? We've given you everything, they say. Why won't you flourish? Thank you.
Thank you so much. Another round of applause for Geffrey Davis, Arisa White, and Don Lundy Martin. Amazing. I also want to invite you to mark your calendars for our upcoming program next Monday with Amy, I'm going to mess up her name, Nezukumatatu, and Willie Perdomo at Queens College at 6:30 p.m. Thank you for coming. There's books in the back. Please buy them and have the author sign them and eat and drink. Thank you so much for coming.